Now, this week, there were some terrifying things going on. Only one of which, of course, is Casey Kasem. At this time, it's been maintained that he is in end-of-life care. For those listeners who are not aware of what's going on, Carrie Kasem has been playing into the attorney hands and fighting for her father's body all of this time. Now, he was with his wife, and he could have passed in solitude in a happy place with his wife at his side. And rather than that happening, the attorneys are involved. And Carrie Kasem has been ordered to have conservatorship over her father. And this means that the attorneys have their hand in the pot into Casey and Jean's assets. For those of you who believe that Jean is after money, her net worth is approximately 80 million. This has nothing to do with money. Jean is about to be made a widow as she is being terrorized by court process, as their estate is being raised by attorneys through the use of his daughter, her stepdaughter, who's looking to get one-third of $2 million in life insurance. Now, this has been playing out for quite a long time now, and the attorney's fees alone are eating that up. These experts that the judge is ordering, this and that, those monies go away really quickly because she's asking them to do these things in order for her to have this kind of control. And the report is that she's broke, and she's going deeper and deeper and deeper into the hole. And we see this every single day. This is how Jesus is crucified. When Judas, and Judas in Anglo-Saxon merely means with law, when Judas gets involved, that's what happens. Judas delivers up Jesus for crucifixion. And here he is, Casey and Jean, being crucified by legal process. Now, we have the same chief priests and elders in there, corporate counsel, attorneys, and the businesses that they represent, which have always been the elders, the person as defined in the 14th Amendment. And here we have Jesus on the cross once again, over and over again. This just happened to Mickey Rooney. Tracy Morgan right now is in the hospital because of, quote, a Walmart truck driver. And the story is that it sounds like a nice little accident, but when you look into these things, it looks like, as per the evidence, that it was a pit maneuver and that somebody called in Tracy Morgan's insurance. Now, these actors and actresses are highly, highly insured. And they're not insured by you and I. These are corporate insurance programs, mutual insurance programs. And this is what keeps the attorneys in business, especially when they lose their special drawing rights through the Federal Reserve and Treasury access through the Treasury after they've been found guilty of not only human trafficking, but genocide. The way that Jesus is crucified, according to Matthew 27, is that everybody just sits around and is entertained by Casey Kasem and Tracy Morgan and Justin Bieber being crucified by the same chief priests and elders that have always maintained the crucifixion. And it's very important for everybody to read those passages, as Jesus is always crucified because of envy. You want what they have. They have more than you. You always want what another has, because the priest are teaching you that you have to strive to be. These same priests, over and over, are teaching you that you are not until you show a value, a denomination, a weight, other than what God actually stated as Jesus. And in that, he said what? He said, I am. He said, you are already. What are you doing earning the right to be? He also said that you would turn on Jesus 3 times before you eventually woke up. Casey Kasem, of course, isn't the only one. Gene Kasem is not the only one. Justin Bieber is not the only one. Tracy Morgan is not the only one. Every day I'm reading about officers, law enforcement, being fall guys for the corporation. Every day I'm reading more and more murders that are happening at the behest of corporate counsel attorneys. Corporate counsel attorneys cashing in. Corporations filling their coffers with human demise. Every single day. One of those, again, is in Pennsylvania. I want to call everybody's attention back to the Cash for Kids scandal. Judge was found guilty of human trafficking children and selling them to juvenile justice centers, hospitals, youth groups, psychiatrists, attorneys, other judges. But as a pimp, none of the Johns were ever charged for purchasing those children. None of the psychiatrists were ever charged for ruling against those children. None of the entities that bought the children from the judge were ever charged with human trafficking or sexual abuse. And again, right in Pennsylvania, right here in Pennsylvania again. Berks Regional News today, WFMZ.com. Woman in jail for kids skipping school dies in cell. Burn Township, Pennsylvania. A woman died at the Berks County Jail in Burn Township on Saturday. Some legislators are questioning how she died and why she was in jail in the first place. Quote, I have questions as well as what happened to the woman in prison. How did it happen that she passed away? Did she need medical attention and not receive it? No. Eileen Danino, 55, was a mother of 7. She was serving a 48-hour sentence for her children's multiple truancy violations. Hitler gets really pissed off when Hitler Youth are not in the Hitler Youth camp. She was spending time in jail for her children being truant from school and ended up being murdered in and around the same area where judges were recently caught trafficking children. Now, if a child trafficker wants to get at the kiddies, the easiest way for those attorneys to do that is to arrest and kill the parent. Then the children are up for grabs. We need to wake up, people. This is soft cell Nazi Germany. Everybody's already forgotten about the Cash for Kids scandal, of course. That's what it says in the Gelnhausen Charter. Well, you'll just forget anyway. We never learn any lessons. History continuously repeats itself. Over and over. Nazi Germany was not the last time. Pol Pot, it's not one of the rare instances. The American Holocaust The American Holocaust is right here in your backyard. Casey Kasem was being slaughtered by judges and attorneys at the behest of a psychopath who wants money. Tracy Morgan sitting in a hospital, institutionalized because somebody pit his mobile home or whatever that thing was, turned it over. And Walmart came right in and said, hey, if we're responsible, we'll take care of this. Of course they will. Those same attorneys, those very attorneys maintaining corporate welfare for such as Walmart and Sam's, are also cashing in through the medical industry when Tracy Morgan is injured or brought into law. As he's in there, of course his wife or family is going to pay out the nose to keep him alive, to get him back to approximately what he was before. And the attorneys are cashing in on every little thing. Now, Justin Bieber, I've watched him the last year, absolutely crucified by you folks. Let him be crucified, you cry. Let him be crucified. He's never harmed a human being. I read about some vandalism and things of that nature. He's never harmed a human being as you're crucifying him through the media and allowing these things to occur. Attorneys are cashing in on charge after charge, and it's just entertaining for you. Matthew 27, over and over and over and over and over again. Every day, it's put to you, the people. Come on, let's take some accountability for these things now. As you're watching the television programming and listening to the radio broadcasting, this is being put to you. And Pilate is asking you, what should we do? Should we let these attorneys go? Should we let the murderers go? Or should we crucify Jesus? And you sit up there like seals, clapping your hands, because it's so entertaining to watch Justin Bieber be crucified, and it's entertaining to watch Gene and Carrie fighting amongst themselves. Casey Kasem is being slaughtered. And Justin Bieber, he's just a baby. Tracy Morgan, he's just a man. These things are not entertaining. These things are horrifying. But in your socially engineered states, you've been taught to laugh at them. America's Funniest Videos, you've been taught to laugh at pain and suffering, and call it comedy. The formula of comedy is tragedy plus time. It's always painful. Tragedy plus time. The only thing that allows laughter is the time. But it was never funny in the beginning. Somebody fell off that ladder or crunched themselves some other way and received head injuries from a fall. Crashed into something. Those things have never been funny. Through human conditioning, human behavior modification and social engineering, they were taught that it was. It's become funny now to be preyed on, and entertaining to watch others be preyed on, because it's not you this time. And you've been glad in these things because it's not you this time. Those things are not glorious things. It's not glorious that you're not preyed on this time. It's not righteous to watch your neighbor as they're raised without lifting a hand. These things are abhorrent to God. Today somebody was upset over a picture of Jesus with his middle finger up in the air, and they were saying, how dare you, that's disgusting, how dare you. So I asked her, when was that picture taken? Was it a selfie? I mean, the symbology in this space, this realm is just so sick. There aren't any pictures of Jesus. Jesus is God's only begotten Son, the Son of Man. The Son of Man. The Son of Man. A horse has offspring that are horses. A cat has offspring that are cats. A dog's offspring are dogs. Man's offspring are fellow human. They're not anything else. God's Son is human. I think I've got a caller. Let me add him. Let's see here. I'm not finding an ability to add you. Hark, try it again. I think it'll put the station on hold the way that it was. I see Kat and Mad. Just give me 1 minute here so I can pull everybody in. See what Hart has to say tonight. Sorry about that, folks. Kind of slow going here. Let's see. It's still gonna bubble. Well, let's see if I can grab it. Try to call back in, Hawk. These things are so profound to see each and every day as the Son of Man is being crucified over and over. And these same folks, chief priests and elders, which is corporate council and corporations, have been crucifying the Son of Man for a very long time with full-on consent as they patronize it and call it their father. Against everything that was written, against God's word, against your word, the Son of Man. It's you. And in Matthew 18, he speaks that clearly. The Son of Man is come to save that which was lost. He didn't say he was coming. He said, you're already here. 1 Corinthians 6, he said, God has raised up the Lord God, so shall he raise us up by his own power. That's you again. And he goes into depth on that one too. You can only fornicate by giving your body over to a Lord God. And somebody was so mad at me for saying that the other day. He's like, well, who else are we going to fornicate with? Okay, wait, that word fornication, if you were supposed to do it, it would be called marriage. And over again, it points to you. Revelation 19 says that your name is the Word of God. A horse is a horse, of course, of course. If it walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it's a duck. It's a duck. Son of Man. You know, these things are just horrifying to witness. Horrifying to watch all of these things play out again and again and again. From SanDiego6.com, husband and wife SDPD officers plead not guilty to drug charges. So I went to our law enforcement this week and I said, you know what? I want you to use your relativity here. Here's a couple of law enforcement officers. And they go into law enforcement because they want to uphold the law. They want to protect humanity. But the easiest way to crucify them is to allege that they've committed a crime. Although that's not relativity. That's usually not the truth. They were in law enforcement because they were upholding the law in the first place. And a lot of the listeners are screaming, oh no, they're corrupt. No. All of us. When I was little, I wanted to go into law enforcement. When I was little, I wanted to be the freaking president. When I was little and I was indoctrinated and I didn't know that corporations ruled the world and they were once called Rome and Germany, Nazi Germany, the World Courts, 1789 Judiciary Act, and that everything is in banking and insurance. I said to our law enforcement, I said, you know, how are we going to save humanity when humanity is believing all of these CIA presentations? When humanity is stuck on entertainment value? When humanity can dehumanize each other so quickly? Allowing the deaths of mothers that are sitting in jail for children's truancies when their children don't show up to the Hitler youth camps. All of these things of consensus reality. Joseph Goebbels was Hitler's propaganda minister. He said if you repeat a lie often enough, it becomes the truth. And sure enough, we're all witness to this. these things, these gimmicks. We're watching everything play out in Iraq again, as the CIA kills more and more, and now people are running, and 500,000 reported yesterday. 500,000 Jesuses being run off by the same Congress who's been crucifying Jesus forever. Same Senate. Same Caesar, the taker of all things. Caesar's now called the UN. The CFR. And it looks so darn pretty. As the UN and everybody jump in after the CIA blows things up and gasses 1,500 Syrian children. That's what it says in the Geneva Convention, 1864 Geneva Convention. The Red Cross is a place for holding prisoners of war. The Red Cross is a place, a storage facility for prisoners of war. 1929 Geneva Convention says, just in case you ever lose your government, corporations will save you, and you can be held in holding corporations. How's that working out for you? Everybody wants to know why you are a negotiable instrument, how you get there. Well, the court process is called negotiorum gestio, and the attorney is called negotiorum gestor, and they trick you out as a negotiable instrument to the benefit of corporations. No, that's not possible, Tammy. I love America. Well, in 1933, the United States of America declared bankruptcy again. And since that time, human beings have been held prisoners of war by corporations because you lost your government. You don't have a government. You believe you do. And in that belief, it makes it easier to take you as prisoners of war. Do you realize how easy it is not to be a prisoner of war? If you read the 1929 Geneva Convention, it says you're not a prisoner of war if you have a country. Kind of like what Jesus said. Don't call no man your father, not even Christ. So if you live in the House of Representatives and that house is bankrupt, what about patronizing your own house? Not mine. Not anybody else's. But you patronize your own house. And stop being as a prisoner of war, calling something else your father, especially a corporation. When you go into depth on this Tracy Morgan quote accident, to me, you know, it appears by the evidence that this was a hit. And nothing else. Cashing in on insurance. And if you agree with it, if you continue to be entertained by these things, they continue to occur. If you realized all of a sudden that you could pull Jesus off the cross, wouldn't you? taking Jesus off the cross is simple. Stop being entertained by polarity. Polarization, dehumanization, classification. Stop living in denial. Stop patronizing any father. When you stop doing that, and you stop taking up any kind of title, there is no ability of genocide. Genocide can only occur within the 8 stages of genocide. Genocide can only occur if you're classified, if you're polarized, if you're organized away from each other. Secularization, compartmentalization. It cannot occur if you don't have those titles, if you're not patronizing something else, if you're not taking up another culture, religious belief, language, patronizing sports teams, counties, cities, states, countries, other indoctrinated states. You patronize so many things. So many things. And in this, you are separated from the garment. That is how Jesus is crucified. Jesus is crucified by casting lots, taking off titles. And how does it feel? How does it feel when somebody doesn't like you because you're a different religion, a different color, a different gender, a different body size or type? It's like drinking vinegar, isn't it? Exactly as it's written. It says when you're crucified by casting lots, they're handing you vinegar to drink, gall to drink. Why are you feeling those things? Those things are emotions. Jesus always said, now, if they don't want to hear you, dust your feet off and move along. Go elsewhere. Don't cast your pearls to swine. You're around the wrong crowd. And it's not just the wrong crowd. These attorneys are all psychopaths. They're missing the frontal lobe. They're not with the frontal lobe. They're not human. They are an absolutely devolved species that enjoys pitting humanity against itself in order to cash in on the experience. That is otherwise known as controversy. Con meaning with. Trover means something found, a treasure found. Every time you're in controversy, you're just giving a gift to the attorneys. Yay, look what I found. Somebody to pit up against another. And in this, who's Satan? Who is Satan at that point? You know, to atone, the action of atonement, to atone means to pay homage to another Lord God. Satan, the etymology on Satan means it's your adversary. Put two and two together. Well, in this society, when you put two and two together, horses start breeding ducks. Dogs start breeding goats and such. It's very interesting how much indoctrination has been perpetrated against the human race for so very long by another race that is absolutely inferior. Without the frontal lobe, it cannot process as you process. It can counts really well, majors really well, but it does not experience relativity. It's always seeking to be. And so the psychopath missing that frontal lobe is forever in the past tense. It's never, ever relative. It's never in this time. Without that relativity, it is never being. And that's what's referred to as the second death. It's just an existence. And again, you know, that there's so many things that have been perverted by the voice of that psychopath, and allowing these things to occur is absolutely abhorrent to God, especially when it comes to the murder of life itself. When a psychopath tells you that abortion is, quote, legal, and then it defines what life is and what life is not, the irony is in the psychopath is not able to live. It's never be living. It's always in the past tense, seeking to be, reaching to be, never is able to be. And that's where you find all of this anger and hatred towards the human race. The ability to trick out the human being, the ability to sexually abuse the human children, the ability to kill the human father, mother, grandfather, Casey Kasem, those attorneys cashing in don't have relative beings. They don't have empathy. They don't have compassion. They're absolutely not able to be. And they rely on a body politic for their survival as leeches. And under their definition of the ability or the legality of abortion is where you find the absolute irony. That thing, the psychopath, is not living. It's not a sentient being. From the BellinghamHerald.com, fired Miami police sergeant pleads guilty to criminal contempt charge. Again, he's being crucified. Already in prison for a corruption conviction, a fired Miami police sergeant pleaded guilty Wednesday to a criminal contempt charge for retaliating on the internet against fellow officers who assisted the FBI in the probe. In January, federal prosecutors charged Raul Iglesias with posting undercover investigative recordings on a law enforcement website and on YouTube in an effort to smear the reputations of his colleagues in the now disbanded narcotics squad who helped build the case against him. Those audios were the evidence that he was being cannibalized by criminals. And of course, those criminals came back in and asked a judge, oh, help me restrain him. And sure enough, the judge came in to protect the criminals. And now we've got a law enforcement officer being crucified. And who's going to protect him? Who's going to protect you if the criminal enterprise is arresting the law enforcement when law enforcement realizes what's going on? Are you just going to sit around and then just go extinct? I mean, it's so flabbergasting to me. It's like the old stories about the dodo bird and the pictorial depictions of the dodo bird. You know, it describes it as this goofy little bird that walks around, and you know, much like a turkey. A turkey will put its head up in the air with its mouth open while it's raining and drowned because it doesn't have the thought to save itself. That's where humanity is. They're all looking up into the sky while it rains And they're seeing the rain. They're seeing all of these things. But they're not doing anything. They're waiting for others to do something. You've all been waiting for me to get my head lopped off. I'm not stupid. No, I love you all, but I'm not stupid. And I don't mind. I already know these things. But now it's been almost 15 years that everybody's waiting around for me to get my head lopped off. And I expect when I'm 90, you know, and I die naturally, somebody's going to come in and say, oh, I told you so. These things are crazy. I told you she'd get whacked. From the SeattlePI.com, charges failing Kirkland lawyer built clients to keep himself and his ex-wife living rich. Attorney left clients financially destitute and hounded while trying to keep a $40,000 a month lifestyle. A Kirkland attorney caught stealing from more than a dozen clients offered a novel excuse, according to police. Get this one. This is how much compassion and empathy these things have. Accused of leaving his clients without money to pay their debts and medical expenses, personal injury attorney Brian Kirkbody told police his problems was his ex-wife's expensive tastes. Body, a 50-year-old Redmond resident, said he and his soon-to-be ex had become accustomed to a lavish lifestyle that generated living expenses of $40,000 a month, a Kirkland detective said in the charging papers. King County prosecutors claim Body settled the client's claims, sometimes without their consent, and deposited the money in accounts he could raid, renting space at a reputable law office in Kirkland. Body specialized in car crash and slip and fall civil lawsuits against insurance companies. Well, it's interesting. He was stealing from Judas, wasn't he? The $433,500 theft spree went on for more than 3 years, ending in September after Kirkland police launched an investigation. Body has since resigned his law license and was charged earlier this month with 17 counts of felony theft. While the money helped Body keep up appearances while his practice failed, the thefts left his clients in severe financial jeopardy, the Kirkland detective said in charging papers. In many cases, Body's theft has left his victim clients financially destitute and hounded by insurance carriers and medical providers for unpaid medical expenses relating to their injuries, the detective told the court. So they're all cashing in. This guy's just a fall guy. He's not Jesus. Jesus has a frontal lobe. Most of Body's former clients hired him to represent them in personal injury lawsuits seeking payment from insurance carriers for medical costs, lost pay, and property damage. As it turned out, Body was settling lawsuits without his clients' knowledge and cashing the checks cut by insurers, the detective said in charging papers. Body is alleged to have forged his clients' signatures and then lied to them about the status of their lawsuits. One woman told police Body settled her lawsuit after she instructed him not to, and then refused to hand over her share of the settlement. Another woman, who had been seriously injured in a car crash, told officers Body kept the entire $175,000 FRN settlement she was awarded. She got bills. All told, at least 16 people were defrauded by Body, Peterson said in charging papers. Investigators contend the other clients lost anywhere from $5,000 to $154,000 to Body. Interviewed by police in September, Body admitted to the thefts and the settlement fraud. the Kirkland detective said in charging papers. Asked why he did it, Boddy said he and his wife were divorcing and he could no longer afford their lifestyle, the detective continued. Quote, he stated that at one time his practice was lucrative enough to support his lifestyle, but when his income began to falter, he began using money he obtained from client settlements to cover the gap in his personal expenses, the detective said in charging papers. While Boddy admitted to stealing $290,500 from his clients, the detective contended the true number is likely much higher. Boddy is now charged with 15 counts of first-degree theft as well as 2 counts of second-degree theft. He has not been jailed. But it's interesting that he's turning on his wife. It's her fault, not his, of course. So it's interesting how these things are all playing out. Cops road rage today. This one was very sad to read. From the TimesUnion.com, cops road rage punishment seems like a reward. Quote, let's play a game. Let's say you've done something wrong and will therefore be punished. Here's your punishment. You must retire from your job. You will receive a full pension. Your days will be free for whatever your heart desires. Hey, stop smiling. You're being punished. In the real world, of course, retirement is generally seen as a good thing, especially if the retiree will be financially comfortable. But when a cop misbehaves, retirement is treated like a guillotine. Consider the plea deal for Schenectady Detective John Hodling. His road rage charges will be essentially dropped if he trades his badge for golf pants, gardening gloves, or whatever retirement garb he chooses. Poor guy. Hodling is just 46, by the way. This all stems from a terrifying bit of furor Hodling allegedly displayed 13 months ago. The Arnos, grandfather's son and grandson, were traveling down Maple Avenue on an April afternoon. Yes, their Plymouth Neon was probably moving slowly because the teenager behind the wheel was learning to drive. Their plodding pace seemed to have angered Hodling, who was off duty. All was well, the Arnos say, until Hodling's pickup zoomed around them and nearly forced the family from the road. At a red light, Hodling stepped out from his truck to confront the family. An animated discussion followed before Hodling allegedly returned to his vehicle and returned with a gun that he pointed at two members of the family. Quote, I will blank kill you, Hodling said, according to the Arnos. Well, that could certainly put a damper on a family outing. Hodling was placed on paid leave and charged with 2 counts of misdemeanor menacing. Fast forward to the plea deal announced last week by Saratoga County District Attorney James Murphy, the special prosecutor for the case. Charges will be adjourned in contemplation of dismissal if Hodling resigns, performs community service, and takes anger management counseling. The charges disappear if he stays out of trouble for 6 months. The deal is nicely timed, coming just as Hodling hits his 20 years on the job. The hurdle for full pension and retirement benefits. That, folks, is punishment that seems like a reward, and it's not sitting well with the Arno family, as reporter Paul Nelson details elsewhere in today's Times Union. But Murphy says the deal accomplishes his primary goal, quote, getting Hodling off the force. Now, if there's a threat to humanity, you don't just get him off the force and pay him to sit around bored all day, right? That just allows the psychopath to fester. Quote, an ordinary person who's not a police officer would never have to resign from his position, Murphy said. In this case, we thought the most important thing was to have him resign. We didn't want him to come back on the street. You know, it's just so sad when there's law enforcement and then there's psychopaths and there's these agents and then there's these attorneys and more psychopaths saying, oh, our hands are tied. Darn it all. Darn it all. We can't do nothing. You know, the best that we could do was just pay him to go away. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous that these things could be tolerated for so long. Absolutely ridiculous. So many things that are just so wrong, and yet nothing's getting through to humanity. It's like knocking on brick. We'll be back after the breaks, folks. Stick around. And of course, tonight we're also simulcasting on No Borders Radio at noborderradio.co.uk in the UK, as well as Tirnasaur. I'm thankful to have these venues. Thank you, the listener, for keeping us here. So, this week again, we've been watching as Jesus is crucified for entertainment value. And the people keep crying out, "Let him be crucified! Let him be crucified!" As they clap their hands and they rush around and share all these stories, but they don't do anything about it. Casey Kasem is now end of life, and he's not with his wife. He was torn away from his wife by legal process. Corporate counsel that wants a hand in the pot there. Attorneys who are after money and money alone and using socially engineered product to get it. Carrie, of course, is running after a $2 million life insurance settlement. Split three ways. Interestingly enough, as Bo reported last night, divided in three, that is $666,000 that the attorney has dibs on, because of course Carrie Kasem's been fighting this out in court for a very long time to get access to that estate, to vilify Gene, and to cause all manner of harm for money. Why is this personal to me? I'm a widow. I've been there. And as my husband lay dying, it was the loneliest experience I've ever gone through. And after his death, and the other half of me was missing. I was preyed on by funeral homes and attorneys and bankers, insurance agents, and everybody else who has dibs on the widows after their husbands pass. And there's no more protection available. You know, he was blind. Donnie was blind. And I look back now on, you know, walking the streets of Erie. We lived in Erie, Pennsylvania at the time. Not a nice neighborhood. We lived at 24th and Wayne. And for anybody who lives in Erie, it's just about, we lived in the hood. You know, I was putting myself through school and various things. He was my protector. And we used to go out in the middle of the night walking around. Now, I wouldn't dare do that by myself ever at that time or any other, but I was safe with him. And I think about this now and remember him walking with his cane. He couldn't see anything. But I was safe because he was there. I always felt whole. And it's so sad to watch Jean going through what she's going through now. After his passing, everyone came in like vultures to make claims on the littlest things. My head was just spinning. I didn't argue. But that's what it was. It was being surrounded by vultures, hunters, and predators. Something so profound is written in Matthew 22. Matthew 22:23, the same day came to him the Sadducees, which say there is no resurrection, and asked him, saying, Master, Moses said, if a man die having no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise up seed unto his brother. Now there were with us seven brethren, and the first, when he had married a wife, deceased, and having no issue left his wife unto his brother, likewise the second also, and the third unto the seventh. And last of all, the woman died also. Therefore in the resurrection, whose wife shall she be of the seven? For they all had her. Jesus answered and said unto them, You do err, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. But as touching the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, I am the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. And when the multitude heard this, they were astonished at his doctrine. Of course, they were astonished because you have priests perverting the word of God and others to interpret this for you, which leaves you in cognitive dissonance and the inability to realize that you are God. You are Jesus. And you are here and obligated to protect humanity from predation of the state. That's exactly what Jesus was saying. I was preyed on when my husband passed away. Now, if you got rid of the predators, I could not have been preyed on when my husband passed away. I would have never ever experienced this. If there were no predators, I wouldn't have anything to worry about. Our only known predator is, of course, the attorney. And I brought Bo on with us. Are you here, Bo?
Hey, Bo. And yeah, speaking of which, somebody was like, one of those fake Christians was on there talking about the post I did on YouTube where the picture of Jesus giving the finger comes up. And, you know, these things are said by usually people, hardcore indoctrinated Christians that don't understand that Jesus is a derivative of Greek and Latin, meaning our earth,
right,
or your earth. But, you know, I went to this one particular channel anyways. This is a typical agent channel. There's nothing there. There's no posts. There's no nothing. It's just another typical agent trying to keep you from realizing who Jesus really is.
Right.
What Jesus really is.
Right.
What the metaphor is.
Well, and I laughed. I had to comment on that post. I saw it too earlier. I don't know if you saw my comment, but
Yeah, Matthew 22, and you're just speaking of that, so I thought I'd bring that up.
Well, then I asked her if it was a selfie, because, you know, like,
yeah, it's a selfie of Jesus. That's a selfie of Jesus right there.
Well, and any picture of Jesus, you You think about the presentation of that alone is just, it's hilarious. According to their time frames, you know, Jesus was alive in 0. According to their law, the first time Jesus spoke, it was 1140. But regardless, you know, the picture that you had up looked like a selfie. It was interesting to read.
Well, it might have been a selfie. I don't know. He's giving the finger, and he'd have to have a long arm sticking way out there below the camera to have be a selfie. But at any rate, I could see Jesus doing that. So, yeah, definitely have some agents out there, and they want to keep you from realizing things, and I want to keep you from realizing yourself, basically, and keep you back on the, path of the Lord God, not God. That's the whole thing about the Old Testament. It's all about the Lord God.
Right.
Okay? It may say God, may say Lord God, may say Lord, maybe uppercase. Still means, it's still talking about the daddy state. It's a manifest for government.
Right.
Once you realize that, you can crack this code.
Right, and open the book. And that's what it says in Revelation. All things will be revealed to you, God.
So you're never going to realize who you are, you know, if you go to the Catholic Church and there's, I'm my name, all rise and all this nonsense. I started watching the Borgias, so it's kind of revealing that they would present the Pope that way in modern day media, entertainment, whatever. But, I mean, first couple episodes I've watched of the Borgias, the Pope is just a ruthless, you know, evil, another, you know, king dictator type guy, you know? People having people assassinated, and, you know, the rise to the papacy, you know, he had to coerce all the cardinals, and, you know, he did that by pigeon carrier, of course, you know, because the Pope's, the Vatican's all sealed when they're voting, right, you know, but
right.
They still got their pigeon carriers.
Same as now, and when you go back into the politics, one of the most profound is if you look into the history of Martin Luther and the Lutheran religion and the adaptation of Catholicism over into Lutheranism, and you see the play that went on. It's the same thing that the Republicans and Democrats do today. Lutheran, Martin Luther came in and he was arguing against Catholicism, but then he said maybe we should do it this way, and then Lutheranism was, of course, adopted and is actually one of the founding doctrines of Polycratus itself.
All hail the master and chief of the Polycratus.
Yeah. Didn't he do a selfie on the...
Who, the Pope?
No, what's his name? Obama on the whatever throne it is from Game of Thrones a while back. I mean, it's just...
Oh, that was... Yeah, that was photoshopped.
Such a show.
But it came from the White House. The White House tweeted the thing.
Those comments were the funniest, I think, in a long time, because the comments on the YouTube video that you did about it... they're like, oh, that's just a Photoshop. Well, duh. I mean, it's like, what the heck?
Yeah, I like what you were saying about the dodos earlier. I think that's the problem that we face here, is that we face extinction because the people of today are so much like the dodo.
Right, the ones that the king or the Queen of Hearts grabs in the old... Alice in Wonderland, remember those? The really silly, dopey dodo birds that are depicted in Alice in Wonderland. And, you know, for anybody who doesn't get the symbology of that one and the Queen of Hearts, that's just, it sums it all up. The judiciary and the judicial system and the use of feminism. The poor little short king that was so... emasculated by his wife in a feminist society, and then, you know, to indoctrinate children into that type of thought process is something profound. Sorry about that. The cat is not a fixed cat, and he smells a female, and he's not happy with me right now. So
yeah, well, that's too bad. Yeah, okay, well, speaking of fixed cats, I was seeing that Dean Clifford is, his webmaster, his administrator is calling it quits, throwing in the towel.
I wanted to talk about that. Let me see if I can get him in another room real quick. I'll be right back.
Well, yeah, I haven't pulled it up here on my computer again, but... Oh, he was just saying things that he hasn't been in communication with Dean for 7 months. Dean's been made no effort to contact him. He's been taking a lot of heat because Dean, of course, being in jail, he's not able to help people with these things. Did you read it?
No.
I know he sent it over.
I was listening to a little bit earlier when we were talking about it before the show, but I never got a chance to read it. From what was said, it's just so sad because somebody filed a habeas corpus, you know, and then for this guy to now turn on Dean Clifford and now speak about, you know, the stuff that he was speaking of in that article in the Letty's report is informant. He's an informant against him. And you either are a friend or you're not a friend, or you're with somebody or you're not with somebody, but never both. And in this, it looks like there's such a huge presentation of cognitive dissonance, and the actual application. And, you know, this, it's so sad to see people rolling on each other.
Well, I don't think it was this guy from the sound of the story. It doesn't sound like this guy was the one that did the habeas corpus. That's from what I'm gathering here. I'm pulling it up now. I had to break out another computer. I was listening to my recording from last night's show, and that... I thought that mic would sound okay, but it didn't, so... it's not the mic, though. I think it's the computer input. It's just, I had to completely abandon my studio computer from the old place that got raised by the banksters.
So where was that? Let me go there, and then I'll get up to speed here. There it is, right there.
So. Yeah, well, you know, essentially there's some things that were not true about the weapons that were seized, and one of them, you know, that he said that he had was a World War II rifle. And this guy, he did roll on him there and said, well, no, Dean had all these SKS and all
these
weapons.
Okay, they're still commercial crimes. Did Dean ever harm
anybody? Right. I know those are commercial crimes. Right. No, Dean has never harmed anybody. That's why I remain open about who Dean is.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, some of these people are... You know, useful to the system, so they have agents come in there and, you know, keep them going, rolling along. You know, oh, yeah, I'm with the law movement, you know, I help work with you behind the scenes here. And those are handlers, you
right.
know, and handlers don't have to pay useful idiots. Now, if Dean was an agent, he'd be getting paid.
Right.
So.
And not just, you know, these things are... I don't know. And especially with what I'm reading here, this guy says he's certain I will not return and will not want anything to do with the site or with Dean. It has been way too stressful on my part, and it is not possible for me to keep things afloat. Period. And then, it's been a nightmare. Dean is not what he portrays himself to be. Dean just uses people and discards them, wanted me to build a perpetual income milking station for him. Dean is definitely using all their stuff, and he has a driver's license, he has a license plate, he has a registered company, and yes, he files taxes. How does that one get all that if he claims to have rescinded the BC over 3 years ago? I couldn't get a straight answer from him or any of his mob. Now, these things, you know, I know a lot of sheeple citizens who are just scared, and they do hold those things, but this guy, when I read into it, he looks so much like an informant. Why would he be doing that now and not earlier? Why is it pissing him off now but not earlier?
Yes, right. Well, that's one aspect of it. I don't know. But...
No, we can guarantee a word of Rocco.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
I can guarantee you that they're only holding him as a prisoner of war, period.
Right.
They have no contract with him as a citizen.
Right.
This is a political maneuver against Rocco's chosen form of government.
Right. So now put yourself in this guy's shoes. Why is this guy there in the first place? What is his intention in the first place? Because he's backing Dean. And he likes all of these things, and he's going ahead with all of these things, and he's speaking Dean's word. See, I put my life on the line for Rocco, because I know Rocco.
Right.
And I'll continue forever to give myself for Rocco. I can guarantee his word. I speak his word. He speaks my word. We're walking the same way. Bo and I are walking the same way. And there's no question in my mind. And it's so...
Yeah, this guy got into it because he said he just wanted to learn how to get the tax-exempt status, which, again, there's no statutory remedy for their statutes.
Right.
You know, if you're going to go in and claim, okay, I'm a citizen, but I'm not a taxpayer, that's ridiculous on its face,
right.
Because you're either
asking,
a citizen or you're not.
Right, and they're asking for representation. Now, there's that little clause, no taxation without representation. So if you're asking for rights and benefits, you have to pay taxes. And part of that is charges against you. That's for your care and upkeep. If you're patronizing that thing and asking it to be your daddy, that's a representation. If you're asking them for rights and benefits, those are representations. You owe them for that.
Dean does bring to light a lot about the court industrial complex, the system. You know, it shows that they're basically just lawless thugs. Well, which is absolutely true, okay? But if you go in there filing complaints against them, okay, you're entering into their court system, you're patronizing it. Whether you think you're protesting or not, it makes no matter. Under the law of infants,
right. They're
seeing you as dual-minded. Okay, he doesn't know who he is. We'll go ahead and administrate him.
Right, and Santos is the same. You tried to talk to Santos. Rug class is the same. You know, at different times in our life, I met rug class. You met rug class.
Yeah.
These entities are still patronizing that thing. And my concern now when I hear this and I'm reading this now.
They're trying to look a way out from under their system through the system, which is ridiculous on its face.
Patronizing it, which these postures, and it appears to be, I'm a game theorist, so it looks like posturing, and especially for rock class, and it's just the same as Alex Jones. The system relies on cognitive dissonance to fall back on the easier to believe truth. And so when there's failure, when Dean Clifford is outed by this guy or Alex Jones is pulled down and people are saying CIA or whatever, the sheep will end up going right back into the arms of the state because they're looking for a guru.
Yes.
They're not able to find the self, and that's the requirement. Jesus said, know thyself. Don't follow a guru. Don't follow the new Messiah. Don't follow that the one that has all the bells and whistles. Know thyself. Patronize your own house. Be the author of the book. And sadly, you know, these things, you know, reading that just now and talking about earlier, like I said, it looks like a posture that's just looks like it's going to have the same effect as it always has, and sheep will fall right back onto the state because they were following Dean Clifford.
Whether Dean's in on it or not,
right,
it makes no difference. The, right. The overall effect is the same. It also says here that his grow operation wasn't just for a sick individual. It was a commercial endeavor. So there's some things,
well,
unfortunately,
and
it's come, you know, that they're,
and
this guy put out about Dean, I mean.
But it's in writing, and it's in this guy's hand and his voice, but there's no evidence presented along with this yet. And so
right.
Everything has to be taken with a grain of salt. And remember, do not turn on Jesus. If Dean Clifford is perhaps a victim of whatever's going on, he could be an agent, but until he's evidenced to be an agent, he's known as Jesus.
Yeah. Now, I had told him about some of these terms over and over again in Skype rooms he was sharing jointly and in, you know, IMs, because he is on my Skype list, even though it's been so long now, of course, he's been locked up. But, you know, terms he's using like domicile and, what's the other one?
Living man or something.
Non-resident inhabitant.
Right.
Now, if you inhabit someplace,
right,
okay,
you live there. You're representatives.
You're inhabiting the Lord God's
house
there, aren't you?
And that's why Jesus said.
You can look the term up in Blacks, and it says it right there. Blacks Law. Everyone say, no, well, you got to look at this law dictionary here. Don't look at that Blacks Law. No, if you want to understand what the attorneys are saying, you go to Black's Law.
And look at all of them. Look at the etymology on Latin as well. And Greek.
Well, I was going to get to that. But, the etymology and the fact that the language of commerce is Greek suffix and Latin. I'm sorry, Greek prefix and Latin suffix.
Right. And vice versa. You'd want to look at the prefix, suffixes, and roots. Because those all put together are known as English.
Yeah.
That's all this is. You are not speaking a new language called English. Everybody's speaking Greek, Latin, and Roman that's called English and given different definitions now. But it's stemming from the same, very same lexicon, which means with law, dictionaries. So you want to look up the Latin and the Greek roots, suffixes, and prefixes to find out what English is actually saying, because it's something entirely different than what most believe.
Now, speaking of gurus, I mostly am at odds with all of them, and you know, including Mark Stevens. But Mark Stevens and I, we exchange opinions quite often, and he does not he takes it. I mean, he at least he'll, you know, let you have your say, and we've had our say with each other quite often, and there's some things that he says that is quite true. That for example, there is, you know, he says there's no such thing as government. Well, Okay.
You're being governed.
I mean, you are being governed, so there is a government. But what he says about government, I find to be absolutely true. They're just a bunch of people forcing you to pay you, the stranger, at the end of a gun. I mean, that's pretty much the nail on the head.
Right, but there's two facets. There's consent and force.
Right. But, of course, if you don't consent, they're going to force you. That's their modus operandi. We've seen that with Rocco. No, Rocco divested title properly, absolutely, completely, all evidence on the record. All right? Now, this is why we're at a sticking point with law enforcement, because everything has lawfully been taken care of. It's been taken care of lawfully.
Absolutely.
And these guys are still holding them at the end of a gun.
For now. But there are things that we cannot speak of, and just for a few more days here. I forgot what I was going to say.
Yeah, but that is kind of funny that, you know, we're just a bunch of strangers to these thugs calling themselves government, and they're making us pay them by force.
Right, and that stems right from the Forest and Chase's Charter, natural resources, and then that's where that word lat attack comes from. Fiant is just scat in the forest, feces.
Now that's Craig Kurt right there. He's Latitat. I kicked him out of my Skype room.
Aww.
You know, like some time ago. And then he comes. Then all of a sudden he's back in there,
right,
posting an advertisement for his stinky old common law show that he's got going on there. That he's so excited about.
It was funny because he was one of the agents the other day. I saw that come across one of the news feeds there, that when the FBI agent, the former TSA agent, killed the sheriff the other day, before it came out in all of the works that he was TSA, Craig Kirk was making a claim that he was some kind of a sovereign citizen and trying to vilify the citizenry, when in reality that guy was a TSA agent. And,
yes,
you know, for him to show up in your room, that's funny, trying to get people out of your room, because he's nothing but...
Well, I kicked him out way back when he turned on Rocco, you know.
Oh, yeah. That was sick. And all of that is in evidence as well. And that will be taken care of. Right now, the pressing aspect is, you know, the main players, but...
Yeah, now he's pushing some kind of common law, statutory remedy nonsense, and common law is basically communism.
Right.
Under Star Decisis 1938, right, when all this case law precedence was set up.
Right. And all it is a decision based on a former case, an already established case, and not based on any evidence. And this is what attorney work product doctrine is the ability of the attorney to have a patent on that product and thereby say what is evidence and what is not evidence, or what's admissible, what's not admissible, when in reality evidence is evidence is evidence is evidence. And the only ability a judge has is to view evidence and rule accordingly. If there is no evidence on court record, there is never a judge in that, quote, court. That is a banker only.
Yeah, and so we've got all kinds of evidence that Craig Kirk is doing nothing but delivering people up. But the sheeple are so gullible, and they're looking for remedy when they should be looking for the cure,
right.
Okay? And, you know, looking for relief any way they can get it. They're trying all this stuff. They're going to throw everything at the wall to see what sticks.
Right.
And here comes Craig Kirk, you know, with his
handout.
Wood chopper remedy of, you know, just hammering cold pleading.
Well, and he tells people to get damages.
Yeah, that's renting one's body.
Right.
And we don't do that under the public law. But just coercing people to go into court is delivering them up. That is the action of delivering them up that is spoken about
in the Bible.
By Jesus.
Yes, he says, oh my gosh, what he says about those who deliver them up is that they receive the greater damnation. And that's his lot in life. That's what he's done.
And I told him that. I told him that. And he just goes on and on.
Oh no. Somebody's going to sideline him. No, he's going to deliver up the wrong person one of these days.
Rod Glass, I guess he's still battling away, you know, chomping at the bit too, trying to, you know, crack the judiciary code from within, which is impossible because under that Judiciary Act,
routing system.
Well, they were allowed to create these courts as places of business, and the judge was allowed to be the banker right there back right. in 1789.
Well, and then Rod Class, he says he's a citizen under that 1789 Judiciary Act. That means that he's
worse.
Living in the bank.
D.C. citizen, because he's a private attorney general with a congressional seal. He has a seal from Congress, the transgressors themselves, stamping their approval on this. Oh, yeah, we'll go ahead. We'll bank on this.
Absolutely.
Saying.
And again, that's Judas.
That's a private seal.
It's Judas. You know, what's he got to gain or lose? I mean, a lot of the time, these folks have stuff held over their heads, and that's why they're sellouts for humanity. You never know until you find out later when they pull it back out of their closets and they want to get rid of these idiots.
Now, I hate talking bad about any of these people out there because I learned so much from many of them about the codes themselves, the statutes, and you know, how that works and how that's supposed to work anyways, okay? But they haven't grown. They haven't gone on beyond that. They want to still get back down on their knees and plead to that transgressor called Congress as their daddy.
Right. And again, it's delivering them up. If they're preaching that, they're teaching the leaven of the Pharisee. And Jesus spoke against that as well, you know, and said, look, you're just so horrifying by teaching the leaven of the Pharisee. That's horrifying. Stop doing that.
Yeah, well, I didn't know that, obviously, when I was just looking for anything. I'm trying to figure out, how can they do this?
Right, but you weren't teaching it. You were studying it and researching it, and then you were, you know.
Well, I repost
you,
YouTube videos and
right?
such.
But when I first met you and ran into you, you know, you were pointing me out to others and you know, everybody's required to use their own discretion. And then what happened? You know, throughout time, you used your discretion, and I bought into everything. I'm a female. You know, it was worse for me. I mean, you guys have logic.
Yeah.
You guys have
logic.
I was
supposed to.
But years ago, you know, I used to buy into all sorts of stuff.
You've got more nads than about 99.9% of the males out there because, well, I don't want to drive without a driver's license. Oh, my God. How will I survive without my insurance in case something happens to me?
No, I can't. The minute that I realized that if I registered, if I got a license, if I did anything, any type of interaction with the system, that it rings a millstone around somebody else's neck, that's when I stopped doing everything. And that's a requirement. I mean, the Sester Kivai Trust itself is in two parts, the use and the vi. And the female forever has been used as a use against the male, which is the life that measures, or the vi. And in that, every time that I register, every time that I seek anything, contract, every time I seek a title, every time I get a license or whatever, it holds a male. It doesn't matter who it is. It holds a male accountable for my works and actions. And that's how the system has always gone on and how it works.
And most of these guys out there should have already seen this by now because most of the people that have been married most of them end up getting divorced. And you see that directly in a divorce, how it plays out for you as the male. It doesn't end up well, usually, does it?
Not at all. And it's always been horrifying to me.
You got kids, she gets the kids, she gets all your money. And then he, of course, says, well, that's just the way it goes. And that's just business.
That's why I don't register, and that's why I implore everybody else to patronize their own house. Get out of the system, because you're the one that's wrapping the millstone around your brother's neck. It's because you're patronizing that thing. It's because you're saluting its flag. It's because you're garnering licenses to get married, and because you're garnering licenses to drive, asking it for rights and benefits.
You know, speaking of which, I guess, you know, Hillary Clinton was downtown Chicago a couple days ago, and the McCormick Center was just packed. I can't believe people are still patronizing these monsters that are ruling over you, especially the Clintons. My God, do you guys realize the history of the Clintons?
Was it really packed? Because we
found
out a while back about Obama having a whole bunch of people that were working behind the scenes to like his posts.
These are people from Chicago. If you ever met people from Chicago, I mean, unfortunately, most of them are just, they're just good citizens, you know, and Democrats.
Yeah.
They like that Democratic daddy.
The Lincoln State. They like Lincoln. It's still patriotic.
Oh, yeah. That was another thing. So she called Lincoln a senator instead of a congressman. Okay, they made a big deal about that on CNN. All right, I don't care. He was calling for what he was. He was an attorney.
An attorney. They're only turning the attention away from what he was. And that's something that happened a while back on Facebook. Somebody was bringing up a quote out of Lincoln the Vampire Slayer, and I had to laugh because they were acting as if it was historical. And I'm like, yeah, Congress never made slavery legal or anything. It was all those damn vampires, you know. Lincoln was a good guy. He never did anything bad in the 14th Amendment, giving life to the corporation. It was all those damn vampires. And, you know, the sheeple are buying into that. They really, 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 really like this system.
And he was saving us from slavery by kicking all those vampires' butts.
Oh, my gosh. And the human
that was a funny beings. That was a funny flick.
It was horrible because it was just,
well,
so
it was horrible, but it's funny at the same time. I mean, because, I mean, here it is. The industry is basically run. Hollywood's basically driven by politics, right?
Absolutely.
And if not the CIA having the final word on the script writing, of course, going back to the Wizard of Oz, and which was proven, I mean, evidenced.
It's written on the BBG.gov.
Yeah, yeah, well, right. They go right to the BBG.gov, and you can see it. So my point about that was that, you know, here it is, basically an arm of Congress, you know, pointing the finger at the vampires, not Congress.
Absolutely.
Don't look at us, Congress. Look, it's them vampires.
Absolutely.
It was just them vampires.
And it's always the same, over and over and over again. And if people only realize, you know, law enforcement and citizens were slaughtering each other back then during that time because Congress had made slavery legal. And law enforcement was enforcing those laws. And so citizens only saw law enforcement. Citizens only killed law enforcement. Law enforcement only killed citizens. Nobody took off after Congress. Nobody held Congress accountable. When Lindbergh came in and stood on the House floor back in 1917, he says, look, you guys are a bunch of criminals. He went after J.P. Morgan, the law firm, and all of the House of Representative members there that were in cahoots with J.P. Morgan. He pointed his finger all around and he says, you guys are a bunch of criminals.
Yeah.
And then what happened? They killed his son. They ended up killing his son, and nobody ever held Congress accountable. And the same thing happened over and over again with McFadden, Thomas McFadden. Same thing happened with my sister Nancy Schaefer. You know, this is...
Yeah, Nancy Schaefer, who gave Alex Jones all the information she had on the child trafficking ring to Alex Jones. And then 2 weeks I don't know, it wasn't long after. She was supposed to be on within 2 weeks, and then, you know, he canceled her, and it wasn't long after that that she was offed.
Right, it was within that 2 weeks, and she was dead by, I think it was April 24th, and they said that her husband shot her in the head. He had cancer, they said, in the original reports, and then he shot himself, and then it came out later, well, no, he never had cancer. Okay, now what's the story? But just the year before that, George Zinkhan, one of our brothers, he was a psychologist working at the Georgia University. He was teaching consumptive behavior and human compulsion. What compels you to do what you do? They said that he ended up offing his family, and he drove up into the Georgia mountains, buried himself, and then shot himself in the head. Now, if you follow him all the way through from 2009... till this year. Last year they were still redistributing his estate because they killed his wife, they killed him, and they got the other family members to fight over those children. And the attorneys have walked away with all of the money. And it was the same with Nancy. Same with Lindbergh. Same with McFadden. Until now. And the sheeple citizens must stand up now.
And so what happened to all these people? They're dead. So that just goes to show that the only Congress is, the only good Congress is dead Congress.
Right. They have to be in Gitmo.
Of course, they're dead for real now, right, since we found them all lost at sea. We couldn't find any evidence of life from any of them.
Right. They're all
including
dead,
Congress, attorneys, which is the same thing, basically.
Right.
The attorneys are just, you know, basically arms of Congress. I got the corporate counsel attorneys out there, you know, coming in, you know, under Congress, and they're writing all the policy for the police officers. Oh, I can't figure out, why are the police getting so militarized? You know, Robert Menard was doing a video the other night. I talked about it on my show last night about the militarized police, and you know, it just made him angry how this young kid was just so ready to hurt him. And it, and Rob is a non-violent guy, and it was just angry. And he can't figure out that it's the attorneys that create these people the way they are. You know? I mean, you think that they come up with this on their own, that it's a war zone out there now? No, it's the attorney saying, you know, feed them all this information and getting them all pumped up.
Right.
Or the police chief, which is basically federal.
Right, always. But that was something beautiful that we saw this last week. The law enforcement in South Bend, Indiana, were going after their police chief, and we called him out last year as being federal agent. He came in, he was hired, I believe it was last year, when they wanted to fix what they had done. Andrew Seward threw everything for the federal state. They brought in this FBI former attorney to be the police chief in South Bend.
Yeah, this guy was an attorney.
Right.
And then also probably trained by Quantico, or I think he was, as right. I looked that up. And, yeah, so that's, you know, on the federal level, so he's attorney, FBI, police chief.
Right.
That's what he is.
Same as that other Congress member that was FBI attorney in Congress and all these things.
And the police here, you know, locally, they're telling him that their complaint is that he is running amok.
Right, absolutely. And there's four officers now that are against him, and everybody needs to really watch and pay attention to this one to make sure that those officers are safe from harm.
Yeah, no kidding.
We've been watching this play out for a very long time since they lost their funding, and each time these law enforcement officers turn on the FBI, turn on the federal handlers, turn on the CIA, they're being cannibalized swiftly, like that couple out in California now charged with drug crimes and everything like that. And everybody needs to rally around actual relative law enforcement, whom we love dearly. They're just you and I. They've been so suckered by the corporate counsel attorneys, so suckered by the system. And most don't even realize that they are too prisoners of war since 1929 Geneva Convention.
Yeah, but the attorney's got them so rabble-roused that they're killing people.
Absolutely, and it's so sad. They did the same thing back at the Civil War. Same thing. Congress got the citizens and law enforcement to kill each other.
Now, they're also running a story here I saw lately that police shootings, in other words, cops getting shot, are up like 55-57% over last year.
And that's Congress, the majority of Congress.
But that's,
Congress is calling out for these no-knock warrants.
Yep.
You know, these lawmakers are putting human beings and law enforcement, citizens and law enforcement, in harm's way by what they're doing. This is
well, that's
a
civil what they,
war.
That's what they got to do to keep the heat off themselves.
Yes, but they're promoting civil war.
That's what
war.
They're doing. Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, but it's just getting really, really ramping it up, you know, and it's just not here with the law enforcement. It's globally with law enforcement and with the CIA productions. This incident in Iraq, you know, what's going on in the Ukraine and Syria, okay, and then we got, you know, Russia here launches a surprise lateral mission alongside of NATO's war maneuvers. And that was the big surprise. Okay, well, think back to that photograph of George W. and Putin and the leader of China, where they're all dressed in their Masonic lodge garb, and they're all one big happy family.
It's called the Russian Federation. They're part of the Confederacy.
So do you really believe that was a surprise that CNN would lead you to believe? It's just unbelievable. And so as they ramp up these productions, they're gonna sell it to you over and over again in the media.
Mainstream media.
Yeah. You know,
we're almost out of time tonight. I want to remind everybody, you know, we hosts are sweating here. Last night, for those of you that have joined in since the top of the hour, our donations are down quite considerably this month, and we've got a few days to catch up here. It's the 12th now, but if you can donate, now would be the time to donate, and we appreciate every bit of support that you give us because we're listener-supported. And to donate, please visit us at www.freedomslips.com and click on our support pages. You can mail your donation to Hawk. Also, I know that there's a lot of stuff going on with Hawk's birthday's coming up too. Hopefully we can all get together. I'm hoping. I'm not sure yet if we're available, but we're trying our best to get things situated here, but again, we are not corporate sponsored. We are not federally funded in any way. And therefore, we only bring you the truth. And, you know, we're not paid to blow smoke. Do you have any parting words, Bo, before the bell?
Yeah, yeah. They say the voters' turnouts are low. Okay, good. Let's get them down to zero. Quit voting for that Congress to rule over you and genocide you and all the rest of it. What are you guys, nuts?
Be well, everybody.